Hello, I'm Mark, and welcome back to Design Optics Fast, where we help you to design optics fast. Today, we're going to start looking at the Cooke triplets as part of our Basic Shapes of Imaging Systems series. And this is really interesting because the Cooke triplets has enough degrees of freedom to be able to compensate all aberrations and therefore have a fighting chance of meeting our spec. So come on, join me, let's have a look at this and let's design a Cooke triplet together. Okay, so we're going to start by picking up the landscape lens template again. We need to add two new elements in front of the stop for the Cooke triplet. So I'm going to just click on the surface number 2 and I'm going to press insert 4 times. And now I've got those 4 surfaces. I'm going to just give them all thicknesses of like 5 millimeters. So you can see them. And I'll make the first one out of NBK7. I'll make the second one out of NF2. And those are just the same choices that I used for the color corrected doublet. They're perfectly good choices. Let me just show you the whole system. By the way, you can see in the merit function, the Optic Studio has also inserted new operands for the new surfaces that we've added. So we don't actually have to do anything to the merit function editor as a result of this. I'm just going to close that now. We also know that the Cooke triplets is a positive, negative, positive configuration. So I'm just going to give it some starting data that puts it in that sort of positive and then negative configuration like so. And I typically just tend to use for radii and thicknesses values like 1, 2, 5, 10, 20, 50, 100, 200, 500. Just rough steps that just get me something that looks like it's right and nothing really more than that. We're going to want to optimize these parameters. So I'm just going to highlight them all with the mouse and then do Control Z and that makes them all variable. And we're also going to want to optimize the glasses and they're done somewhat differently. They're done using this substitute solve, put on like so. And the quick way is just to enter to get the solve dialog box, S for the substitute solve and enter to close the solve dialog box. And that makes it a very quick way to set substitutes on any particular glass. There's a little bit more that I need to do, however. With the landscape lens, the stop was the first surface, and so the stop diameter was the same as the entrance pupil by definition. But here you can see the stop semi-diameter is 5 millimeters, so the stop diameter is 10 millimeters, but the entrance pupil diameter is 11.9 millimeters. And that's because of the magnification introduced by the optics in front of the lens. So since I actually want a 10 millimeter entrance pupil diameter, I'm not going to use float by stop any longer. I'm going to use entrance pupil diameter and give it a value of 10 millimeters. I'm going to let the stop surface be whatever size it wants to be. And you'll see it wants to be 4.183, but let's just look a little bit closer at that. And you can see if you do so, that the marginal rays are actually not quite hitting the lens. And this is called pupil aberration. And it's caused because the optics in front of the lens don't just form an image of the stop, they form an aberrated image of the stop. And so we want to account for that pupil aberration. There's a nice little graph you can use for pupil aberration that just shows how much pupil aberration you have at each field point. And you can see at the edge of the field, we've got about 5 or 6% pupil aberration. Well, the way to resolve that is to use a technique called ray aiming, which ensures that the stop is the thing that is correctly illuminated. And so the entrance pupil diameter is still 10 millimeters, but you can see now that the stop size has reduced slightly to 4.192, so that is exactly where the marginal rays are landing and not where the paraxial equivalents of the marginal rays are landing. That's an important thing to set up. A couple of other things we'll just do by way of tidying up. Under the Optimize tab, I'll just refocus the lens. Doesn't really make a huge difference, but you know, it just means I'm starting from a focused point. And because I'm going to choose new glasses, I'm going to use the same glasses as we used for the color corrected landscape, which are the ones that meet these criteria of a maximum relative cost of 5, a maximum climate resistance of 2, and a maximum stain resistance of 1. So that's all good. I'll just click on OK with that. And I've now got my template for the Cook triplet. So I'm simply going to change the documentation. And a fully scalable starting point for the Cook triplet lens design. And I'll just save this as Cook template, and we're ready to go on and optimize it. So now we're ready to actually optimize. I've just opened a report graphic and set up these four windows all in one. And that's just so that I can call these up quickly whenever I want and have them all set up just the way I want. So let's move to optimize. And because we're wanting to select the best glasses, we're going to go straight for the hammer optimizer. Make sure that auto update is selected there. Hit start. And just off it will go. And every time it comes up with a new design, you'll see these windows updating as a result. And you can see that we're pretty quickly moving down into the sort of range that we were seeing with the earlier designs. Ah, now, see here, we're into a design that is pretty good, to be honest. What we're going to do is just leave this to run for a little while. Generally speaking, when using the hammer, a couple of things to bear in mind. First of all, it never stops. It just carries on going and going and going. And that's the kind of metaphor of the name hammer, is the idea of somebody just keeping going, trying to find improvements. What I tend to do is just leave it and just watch this last save number here. And when that last save is about 2 or 3 minutes, you know, that's about the time I will stop it. Now, I happen to know for this design how good it will get because I've run this specific example several times and I know how good this design will get. So I have a slight advantage here over what you would normally have. So in real life, just watch that last save and allow it to run until the last save is 2 or 3 minutes old, and then it's probably about the right time just to stop. But do remember that you can run hammer overnight, when you go for lunch, when you're in a meeting with your boss, any number of times you can just let the hammer run and it will just bang away trying to improve that design. Note also you can see here how the glasses are changing as well as the individual variable values. Now, nobody wants to watch a dialogue box for 3 minutes on YouTube. So I've edited this section down and I've stopped at a merit function value of 0.00058. This is a very good design and it's well within the specification that we set that the RMS spot be comparable to the Airy disk radius. So how does it work? Look at the Zeidel plot and you'll see how this is actually working. You'll see how the aberrations of individual surfaces are balanced such that the overall system sum is much smaller than any of the individual surfaces by themselves. Now, it's an important thing to realize, but we did not optimize for aberrations. Aberrations are limited to specific orders. These are third order aberrations, for example. And yet, if you look at the Rayfan plot, and I'll just look strictly on axis first. Now, if you're not familiar with the Rayfan plot, don't worry, because we'll cover that in a later section. But note here, if I just follow the red line, the slope through the origin here is the focus error. The turning point here is spherical aberration, which is balancing the focus error, and then this other turning point here is higher order spherical, which is balancing the lower order spherical. Now, you don't get that out of just zygal aberrations. What we do, if you remember right back at the landscape lens, when we set up the merit function, we said we wanted the smallest possible spot, and we used a Gaussian quadrature algorithm that was accurate to r to the power 9. In other words, it could take spherical, higher order spherical, and higher order spherical into account. And that's more than we need for this particular design. So our merit function is actually exact relative to the aberration, this design. And so although aberration plots like the zygal diagram are useful in terms of understanding the performance of the design, they're limited to third order, which the optimization is not. The optimization will work to any order that you care to use. And so there's a really important point here, which is don't attempt to control aberrations directly. Aberrations are simply mathematical constructs used to simplify the design process before there were fast computers. Always design now in terms of the things that you will physically measure. And these are things like spot size, wavefront error, MTF, and so on. In the merit function, there are tools to let you sample these properties to whatever order of aberration you require. And I typically use 5 rings, which gives me r to the 9th control of aberrations, and that's good for virtually any optical design these days. The merit function, though, should represent what you want to physically measure when you test the system or you use the system or your customer's using the system. Leave the aberration balancing to the optimizer and then use what the aberrations are telling you about performance to guide how you evolve the design in order to meet your spec. Now, I intend to cover productionizing optical systems in a lot of detail later. It's its own part of optical design. But this design shows two specific production issues that you'll meet regularly in real-world optical design, and they're best addressed early. The first thing that I don't like is that the central lens is very nearly symmetric. Has radii of minus 23 and 18.5. It's hard to tell these radii apart visually. This is going to lead to issues on the shop floor, with assembly technicians accidentally putting the lens in the wrong way round. Now, if the design must have a nearly symmetric shape, then that's fine, and there are ways of handling those kind of issues, but it's best if you can avoid that problem. The second thing I don't like is that the first lens has a very long back surface. This surface is almost, but not quite, flat. Very long radii are difficult to measure accurately and are more expensive to make than flat surfaces. So it would be better if this surface was flat rather than very long. Now, when we see issues like this in a design, we can address them in two ways: by constraints in the merit function, as we did with the edge and center thickness constraints, or by setup in the lens data editor. If it's available, changing the setup in the lens data editor is always the easiest and fastest choice. So we're going to make the following changes. On that central lens, instead of the radius of surface 5 being variable, I'm simply going to make it a pickup from surface 4 with a scale factor of minus 1. And that will force that lens to be bivex. And you can see the performance has been dramatically lost. Don't worry about that for now, we'll recover it. I'm also just going to go to the radius of the last surface and do Control Z to remove the variable and just make infinitely flat lens. The merit function is huge. However, we've got two fewer variables than before and no extra constraints in the merit function, so optimization speed will be improved. So I'm just going to run the hammer again, starting from the starting point, and we'll see that the design performance can be recovered very, very quickly. Again, I'm just going to let this run for a little while until I'm you know, it's gotten as good as it's going to get, as it were. But we should be able to recover the performance of this lens to the level that that was at least comparable to what we had before. It won't be better than it was before because this design has more constraints. So we only have 10 variables instead of 12, but it should be adequate. And again, I'll just leave the hammer optimizer to run until the last save is something like 2 or 3 minutes old, or the merit function itself has gotten down to something comparable. And it's currently 0.0073, and I had previously, I think, 0.00058. So I've got a little bit of distance to go. But you can see here the performance is, I think, within spec. The spot size is comparable to the Airy disc, but I think it can still get a little bit better from where it is right now. I'm going to stop at this point because the performance has been recaptured to effectively the same as the original performance. And so by just adding these two constraints and then rehammering the lens, I was able to recapture the original performance of the lens, but I have a more manufacturable basic shape. If you look at the RMS spot graphs, you can see that the performance is effectively identical. In summary, we started with a landscape lens template again and added two new elements in front of the stop. We guessed at initial values for these two lenses. Because there's power in front of the stop surface, the entrance pupil and the stop surface aperture are no longer the same thing. So we used entrance pupil diameter as the aperture definition, and we turned on ray aiming to account for pupil aberrations and ensure that the stop is correctly illuminated. We set a glass substitution template and used the hammer optimizer to find the best lens shapes and glasses for this application. Good news, we met our specification. The aberrations introduced by each surface balance with each other to give a low system sum. This is the value of aberrations. They give you a language to describe the performance of the lens and to decide what to do if you need to improve performance. Don't optimize directly for aberrations. Let the optimizer balance the aberrations as necessary to give the best spot size across the aperture, field of view, and wavelength range of the design.